Every moment is a political moment, but there's an argument to be made that right now is an especially political moment. Everyone has something to say. Some writers set out to make a point or to change people's minds. Others aren't trying to do anything like that, they just want to tell a story. But it doesn't matter what a writer's goals are. Whether they mean to or not, their feelings are going to come through in their work. Sometimes it's part of the plan, built into the outline. And sometimes it just happens and a writer doesn't realize they're doing it at all. This isn't a good thing or a bad thing, it's just the reality of storytelling. There's no one right way to put a message in a story, though there are some wrong ones. Preaching, for example. Stories don't have to be subtle. In fact, the industry frowns on it. But just because a work is upfront with its themes doesn't mean it's preaching. People might describe a work with an obvious agenda as being preachy, but that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about literal preaching. My favorite example of this is an author that I won't name because I shouldn't be throwing stones. This guy's written dozens of books, and among people my age and older, he's a pretty well-recognized name. But he wasn't perfect. Every step of the way, in the good books and the bad, you knew how this man felt about things. Most of his commentary related to social issues. It was a little political, but tastefully conservative without being totally bonkers, and that worked for the books that he was writing and the mainstream, kind of moderate audience that he was writing for. So we ended up with some cool stories with generic but likable characters that checked all the boxes and took care of business, and on the whole, it worked. But then it didn't. Like it does for a lot of writers, success got to this guy. He stopped trying so hard to make his feelings a part of the story, and the story started to take a back seat to his feelings. Rather than letting his views shine through the characters, he just started telling you stuff, right there on the page. Not exactly breaking the fourth wall, but leaving a lot of snot and handprints on it. And that was when he fell off. As soon as the books placed more emphasis on the author's soapbox than they did on the story, it stopped working. That particular writer's influence is directly linked to his indulgence. As he got more indulgent, he became less relevant. That guy illustrates my point pretty well. There's nothing wrong with sharing your feelings, and there better not be, because we all do it, whether we mean to or not. But if people want a sermon, they go to church. If they want a story, they open a book. Views can't just be served alongside the writing or in place of it, especially in genre fiction. They have to be integrated. There are a few ways to go about that, and I'm going to talk about some of the main ones, starting with the one that I think is easiest. Most of the methods for this involve things like thought, skill, weaving, narrative, and writing words like that. But this method is the opposite. Don't show, tell. It's like the soapbox easy mode. Gandalf, Dumbledore, Uncle Ben, Michael Caine, old Harrison Ford, Alec Guinness, Liam Neeson. See the pattern? Yeah, they're all old white guys, so we'll throw Aslan in there for diversity. Maybe it's Liam Neeson again, but you get the idea. And you know who, and more importantly, what these characters are. The Gandalfs and the Dumbledores. The wise characters. The wise characters are how you cheat. They're your way to preach without any skill or finesse, because if you can establish one of these characters, they do the thematic work for you. All they have to do is talk. No, you can't have pages and sermons from them, but if you go about it correctly, and your reader is perceiving the character as a Gandalf or a Dumbledore, when that character talks, readers listen.
We do not know who else may be watching.
You don't want to abuse it, and you want to try not to make it too obvious. But if you have one of these characters, and you want to make sure something gets in there, that's how you do it. Obviously, when a character gets to be as iconic as Gandalf or Dumbledore, people assign meaning to every word they say. But even in a normal book that doesn't sell a billion copies, as long as the wise character has wise character status within the confines of that book, their words are still going to guide how the reader interprets it. If the grandfather on his deathbed says something about the environment, maybe as a metaphor to his midlife crisis having son about preserving and cultivating the things that he has to sustain him, the readers will hear it. Don't get me wrong, these characters don't have to be a cheap cop-out, even if they often are. They fit into most stories very naturally and are easy to do. But if you can show that a character is wise and venerable, then that character can just tell your reader whatever you want the reader to hear. It's not the most elegant way to make your point, but it's probably one of the hardest to mess up. Tilda Swinton! There. There's one that's not male. White, yeah. Whitewashed, maybe, but we're all friends here. Still better than that Ghost in the Shell stuff. I guess that isn't saying much. So, the sequel to Free Space doesn't have a release date because of reasons, and the reasons are not that I haven't written it, because I have. I've written the whole series. But anyway, in the meantime, there's still a new space book coming out in May 2018, and of course there's always the first two. You should check that stuff out. Seriously.